Today we are going to see the Linux permissions. Permissions in Linux. Now what is the meaning of permission? Permissions, that means the users, we give users right to access any files and directories. Then we can also give them right to do some task or some job. So these all kind of things we can say it is what permissions, or we can say the restrictions. Now first, in Linux, when we are going to give a permission to any user on files or directory, then we have three type of permissions here. First, we have read permission. We have read permission. Then we have a write permission. Then we have execute permission. So in Linux, we have three permissions: read, write, and execute on any file or any directory. Now, when we talk about the read permission on files, then what we mean is a user which is having a read permission on the file, it can do what? It can open the file and it can read the file. It can read the file, it can see the content of the file. Now, when we talk about the write permission on file, so write permission means user can do what? It can write the file, it can edit the file. It can edit the file and it can edit the content of the file. Then when we say the execute permission, now execute permission means user can do what? When the user has an execute permission, so user can do execute the file. Now the meaning of executing, that means if the file is an executable file. Executable file in Linux, we have binary files and also we have the script files. So if we have any script file in our system, and also if we have a binary file in our system and we want that user should execute those files, then we have to give the user execute permission. So if the user don't have the execute permission, then it is not going to execute anything. Now, when we talk about the directories, so when we talk about the directories, and on the directory, if we give the read permission to the user, that means if the user has a read permission on directory, so directory permission means, directory read permission means user can read the content of the directory. That means user can see what is inside, what files and directories are inside those that directory. So it can do list content. It can do the content, it can do the list content. It can use the ls command and it can do list the content of that directory. Now, when we give the write permission on directory, so when we give a write permission on directory to the user, then user can do what? It can write the content. Now, what is the content we have in a directory? So in a directory, we store files and also subdirectories. So user can do what? It can add a file or remove a file from that directory. So if user has a write permission on the directory, so it can do add a files and it can also remove the file from that directory. Now when we talk about the execute permission on directory, so when we talk about the execute permission on the directory, then what the user can do? So user can actually execute the directory. Now what is the meaning of executing the directory? Executing the directory, that means it can go inside the directory. That means if the user wants to go inside the directory by using the cd command, then it needs to have the execute permission. Remember, read permission only allow the user to read the content, but it will not allow the user to go inside the directory. That means we can use to list the directories without going inside the directory. For listing any directory, we don't have to go to that directory. We can use ls command from anywhere and we can just list the content of that directory. But if you want to go inside the directory by using the cd command, then user must have this execute permission. So if the execute permission is not there, then user cannot switch to that directory. It cannot change to that directory. We cannot use the cd command to that directory. It can only use the, if it is having the read option permission, then it can read the file it can read the directory content, it can list the directory content, but it cannot go inside the directory. Now when we talk about these permissions, read, write and execute, so in a Linux system it is in bits, it is a 3-bit permission. 3-bits permission. Now what the meaning of 3 bits? If you see every bit of binary means we can represent the bits in binary. So if you see the first bit, so the first bit value will be always 1. The second bit value is 2, and the third bit value is always 4. So we have these 3 bits, and these permissions are from these 3 bits. Now what that means, we have the 3 bits, and this is the value of those 3 bits, 1, 2 and 4. Now if suppose this first bit is on and these 2 bits are off, so we do what? We calculate the value of the on bits, and we say this bit decimal value is number 1. Then if this bit is on and these all bits are, this bit, first bit and this last bit is off, then what is the value? Value will be 2. Because of the position of that bit, the value of that bit is number 2 in decimal. Then if this bit is on and these 2 bits are off, so because of the position of that bit, the value for that bit, decimal value for that bit is 4. Now when we talk about the permission here, so this bit, when this bit is on and the value is 1, we get execute permission. That means a decimal number 1, or we can say the first bit of 3 bit is on, then the permission the user will get is execute. Then if this bit is on, that means the value is 2, then a user will get the write permission. And when this bit is on and the user get number 4 decimal, that means it is getting the read permission. So by the bit position, these decimal values of these permissions are, that means read will get 4, write is number 2, and read is execute is decimal number 1. Now we can go for the combinations also. For example, if this and this bit is on and these 2 bits are off, then what number we will get, what decimal number we will get? We will combine 4 and 1, we will get 5. And 5 means what? We are getting read and execute. So permission will be read and execute. Then if suppose these 2 values are on, this and this, and this one is off, so the number will get 6. And 6 means what we are getting? We are getting read. We are getting read and write. So we will get, the user will get read and write. If suppose all the bits gets on, so value will be 7. That means 4 to 6 plus 1 will become 7, and the value, the permission the user will get, what? All the 3 permissions: read, write and execute. So this is what the permissions: read, write and execute. In binaries they are in 3 bits. So in binary position the bits gets on, the user get that permission. First bit value is 1 and user get the execute. Second bit value will be 2, and if the second bit gets on, user will get the write permission. Third bit value is 4, and when this bit gets on, the user gets the read permission. And we can go on for combination, like these two bits will get read write, read execute, and even it can get the whole permission, read write and execute. Now we are here in our system. I will open the terminal here, and I have logged in as a root user, and this is root user's home directory, and under root user's home directory there are some files. So when I do list, so we'll see this here, we'll see this, and we see this is the detail information. Now what these detail informations are, and what the permission, what I told you about this, that this is the permissions. So what is it and how we can read this? So let's see this first. Now this is what we have seen in our system. So when you list those files and directories, you will see like this. When you list it on full, so you will see in long list, you will see like this. Now what we have here, so first we have this is our file name. So whatever you see here, it is the file name or directory name you will see. Then here what you see is the time of the modification and the date of that modification. Here you will see the size of the file or directory. So this is what size and date and time of modification. This is the name of the file. Now what we see here is the permission. Before in between the permission, we see this value. This is actually shows the link, how many links of this file we have. Right now it is only 1. Now what we see here is the permission. So first what we see here, this first value, this actually defines the type of the file. It defines the type of the file, whether this file is a normal file, or it is a directory, or it is any other type of file. This hyphen it means it is a normal file. If you see the directory, then you will see the D here. And for other files, like for the socket file or device file, you will see D there. Device file is there, S, you will see different values. Normally you see the hyphen and D. Hyphen is for the normal file, D is for the directory. Now it looks like it is with this permission. You can see it is completely together. It is completely looking like they are in same, but you have to differentiate between these. You have to remove this first hyphen here, because it defines the type. It will not do, it is not do anything do with anything the permission. So permissions are separately from this. You have to ignore this first. You have to see only this to identify the type of the file. Now the permission start from here and it will end here. Now when you see the permissions, so when you list the long list, you will see the permissions like this. Now this looks like is a single value, but you have to divide it into 3, because remember we have only 3 permissions: read, write and execute. So whenever you see the permission, you have to divide it into 3 permissions of 3 sections. Like for example, this is read, this is write, and here when you see the hyphen, there was here comes the execute permission. The hyphen means it is not there. So use this permission is only read write, no execute. Now you have to divide it. So whenever you see the permission, this is separate permission. Then again these 3 permissions are starting: read, then hyphen, hyphen. That means read permission is there, but no write and no execute. Then you have to divide it from here also. Then again the third section, it is saying read hyphen hyphen. That means again there is only read permission, no write and no execute. So when you see the permission, it looks like a single value, but in your mind you have to see it in 3 sections. You have to see it in 3 sections. And why I am saying 3 sections? Because these each section are for the different user. D these permissions are for different user or different group. So first, the first section of the three permission, that is read, write and execute, whatever the permission is there, either it is only read, write or only read or read, write, execute, this permission is for the owner user. Owner user, that means the owner user, that means the user who created the file and the user who owns the file. So this permission belongs to that user, that is the owner user who created the file. So this permission, first set of permission is for the owner user. So you have to divide three sets of three permissions, read, write and execute. Now it looks single, it looks like a single value, but it is not a single value. It is having a three set permissions of three, a set of three permissions, and you have three sets here. Now first set of permission is for the owner user. The second set of permission is for the owner group. The second set of permission is for the owner group. Now owner group, that means by default it is the primary group of the user. When we create a user, the primary group also created. So when that user create any file, so the owner will be that user and the group owner will be the primary group of that user. That is by default. Now when I say by default, that means we can change it. But by default, the group owner will be the primary group of that particular user who created the file. Then this third set of permission is for others. Now others means all the other users who is not the owner, and also those who is not the member of that group, the group who is owning the file. So all the users who is not the owner and also not the member of this group, owner group, so they will all get this permission, rest of all. Now here this is what the link, but this name indicates that the owner user. So you can see the owner user name here. That means whatever the name you will see here, right now we are seeing root here because this is the user who created the file, because we are seeing the file belongs to the root user's home directory. So all the files belongs to root and root is the owner. So you will see the name of the user here who is own the file, who is owner of the file. That means whatever the name you see here, this set of permission belongs to that user. That means whatever the permission you will see here, read, write, execute or only read, that permission will belong to this root user. This user, whatever the username you see here. Then the next name you see here is a group name. It is the owner group. That means whatever the permission you see here in this middle set, this permission belongs to this group, and this group means all the members of that group. Group will not do anything with the permission. Whatever, whoever the member of this group, they will use that permission. So you can see the first set of permission is for the owner user, and the name you will see here. And the second set of permission is for the owner group, and the name you will see here. And rest of the all user will get the permission of that third set, and that is for the others. Now this is the format of the permission you will see. Three set of permissions you will see when you do the ll command. LL means ls hyphen l, long list. So you will see three set of permission. They are not divided, they look like a single value, but they are divided by set of three permissions, that is read, write and execute. Now you see here there is one dot here. Now this dot indicates advanced permission. It indicates the advanced permissions. It is not a normal permission. This is the normal permissions. Now when we are seeing here, these permissions are for root user. That means root user is getting read, write, then read for the owner group, and all the other will get only read. This is the default permission when the user root creates the file. Now, where these default permissions are coming? So these default permissions are coming because we are not changing anything. These default permissions are automatically coming. Now, where these default permissions are coming? So as we see here in the system, you can see the first D here, and that D means it's a directory, and hyphen means it is a normal file. And you can see these permissions are all combined. It does not look like separate, but you have to look it into a separate three sets. Like for the directory, if you see here, you can see this like this, but you will not combine this here. They are different sets. You can see first set is saying read, write, execute. That means the owner user will get that, and this is the owner user. And then the second set is saying read, execute. That will be given to the owner group and all the members of that group. And the third set, it is saying read, execute for the directory. And this is what for all the other users. Now, these are the default permission. For directory, it is giving this permission. As you can see, all the for files, it is giving this. You can see all the files are having the same permission. And for directory, it is giving this permission. And all the directories are having the same permission. This is all default permissions. Now, as you log into the user account, if you switch to the user account, now this is the normal user, and when you see the files here, so these files are belonging to this user. Owner user is this tech. Owner group is the primary group of this user. Whatever the permission you see, these are all files or all directories. So you can see this permission here. And also when it creates a file, it is getting this default permission. If you can see here, it is getting this default permission. And if it creates any directory, so it is getting this permission. Now this is also a default permission. We are not changing any permission, it is coming automatically. Now this permission is different from root user. If you see the root user create the file, it gets read write for the owner user, then the group owner will get read and others also get read. But here, what it is getting here, owner user is getting read write, then group owner is also getting read write, and only others are getting read. This is for the user's file, and if you see the root file, root user's file, read write for the owner user, and others and group will get only read. This is the default permission. It is coming default. We are not changing anything. These are all default permissions. Now, where these default permissions are coming and why these default permissions are like this? Now first, when it was Unix system, remember all these are coming from Unix. So in Unix system, what happened when we create a file? When we create any file, so the file will get this permission, 6. Now 6 means what? Read is 4, write is 2, and execute is 1. So when I say 6, that means read write. This is for the owner user, and then the group owner also get read write, and others also get read write. That means when in Unix system, in old Unix system, by default the kernel do what? It creates this permission, read write, read write, read write, read write for the owner user and read write for the all other users also. Now when it creates the directory, it gives this permission. 7 is for the owner user, 7 is for the group owner, and also 7 is for the other user. Now the problem is here, this others. That means user creates the file, that user is owner, he can do anything, he can read write, but the same file can be also read write by the other users, all the other users. that is not a good thing. And same for the directory. If user creates the directory, he's the owner, he can get read, write, execute all the permissions, but others can also get the read, write, execute. Now, because of that, in Linux, what we have added in Linux, we have added the umask. So in Linux, we have one thing, it is called umask, and that is user mask. Now, what this umask is? So this umask is different for root user and different for the normal users. For root user, the umask is 0.02. That means for the root user, the umask is 0.02. This is the value. And for other users, for normal users, it is 0.02. Now, what this umask do? So it actually divides, minus this umask from the default permissions of Linux kernel. So what it do here, when root creates the file, so because of the Unix kernel, the file will get this permission. But umask in Linux, what it happens, the umask will be minus from that. That means it will remove the umask. That means for root user, it is 0.02. Now when you remove, when you minus this, so it will become, when you remove 2 from 6, it will be 4. 2 from 6, it will be 4. And 6 will remain 6. This is for the files. Now that is why whenever root user creates any file, it gets this permission, read write, for the owner user, and for the group owner it gets only read, 4 means read, and for the other groups, for the others, it will get only read. And this is the default permission we are seeing when we list the root user's file. And for directory, again the umask will be minus. So 0.02 will be minus from here, this default permission, and it will become 755. It becomes 755. Now 7 means read, write, execute for the owner user, and read, execute for the group owner, and also read, execute for all the other users. And the same permission you will see when you see the files and directory created by root user. So because of this umask, it get this. Now if normal user creates the file, then what they will get, they will that this umask will be minus from that. That means 0.02. And that means when normal user creates any file, so umask, because of umask, the permission will be 6, 6, and 4. Now that means read write for the owner user, and for the owner group also read write, and for all the other users it will give only read. And for the directory, again this is the umask 0.02, and it will become 7, 7, here it will be 5. Now that means read write execute for user owner, then read write execute for the owner group, and for all the other users only read and execute. So this is the permission gets, default permission user gets when normal user creates a file and directory. And when root user creates a file and directory, then it will get the permission after removing this umask, after minusing the umask from this default permissions. So as we saw the permissions in the user's file, user's home directory and root user's home directory, we see here this is root user's file created by root, and what is the permission? It is saying minus read write and then only read to other and group owner. And for directory, this is what 6 4 4. Then for directories, it is giving 7, that means read write execute, and then 5, that is read execute and read execute. So 7 5 5. And for normal user, when normal user creates the file, it gets the permission read write read write read, that means 6 6 4 for files after dividing, after removing, after minusing the umask. And for directory, it gets read write execute and read execute, that means 7 7 5, that is after minusing the umask from the default. Now if you want to check the umask for the user, you can use the command umask. This is a user, this is the normal user, so you can check the umask, and the umask is 002. And if we logged in as a root user, now I am in the root user account, and now if I check umask, I can see the umask is 022. So this is the umask, and because of this umask, this default permissions are like this. So when the user creates the file, it gets this permission. When the user and the group, when the root user create the file, it gets the other permission. Now we know what is the permissions. What are the permission? We have read, write and execute permission. And now we know what is the meaning of read permission on file and directory, and what is the meaning of write permission on file and directory, and also what is the meaning of execute permission on file and directory. Then we have we know now that what is the default permission and where these default permissions are coming and why it is like this. So because of the umask, this is the default permission it is getting by user and other user. Now if we want to change the permission, this is the default permission. Now we want to change the permission. We want to change the permission. Then what we use? We use the command chmod. Now this command is used to change the permission. Now when we want to change the permission, so first we have to know that where the file is, because remember, this is the home directory of root user. Now this home directory is belong to root user, and nobody, no other user can come to this directory. So if I create any file here and I give permission to any user to access the file, to read the file or to write the file, it cannot use that permission because this directory does not allow that user to come into this directory. So no user can come to this directory because this user, this directory belongs to the root user, root user's home directory. So I will do what? I will create one directory here under slash. Now this directory is created by the root user. Now under the directory, I will create one file. So I will create the file by using the touch command, and this file name I will give admin, and then I will add something here that this is admin's file and save it. So this is the file I created here. Now when you check the permission of the directory which we created, so we can see because it is created by the root user, so owner is the root user, and it is getting this default permission read write execute for the owner user and read execute for others and group owner. That means if we have any user, so they can get only what? This other permission if that user is not member of this primary group. Still if the user is the primary group member, this primary group member, still it will get the same permission because right now by default it is getting this read execute permission for owner group and the other users also. Now the file which the user root created under this directory, you can see this is the file, and because it is created by the root user, owner is the root user, and the permission, default permission, is read write for owner user, and the group owner and also the others will get what the read permission, only read. Now if we have the other users, now let's check other users what they get. So I will go to the other terminal and here I will log in as a user one. Now this is the normal user. Now it can list the directory which is created by the root user. Remember, it can list the directory because it is having the read permission by default. Then it also has the execute permission. That means user can do use this cd command and can go into this directory. So it can change into the directory. Now in the directory there is a file created by the root user, and on the file this other user or the other users will get the read permission. And because this user one is also considered as a other user, because it is not the owner and it is also not the member of this root's primary group, so it will consider and it will take the permission of others. So what is the permission for others? Only read. So it can read the file, so it can try to read the content of the file and it can read. Now it will try to edit something. It want to edit this file, so it will try these two signs and it will try to edit the file. Now what it gets here? It gets the permission denied. Permission denied because it has only read permission. Now on a directory also it has only read and execute, no write permission. So user try to create a file in this directory. Say this is my file and it says the permission denied. This is user one. If user two comes, it will get also the same thing, or user 3, it will also get the same thing. It can go to the directory, it can switch, it can see what is inside the directory, it can list the directory, but it cannot create any file because these are all considered as a others. It cannot create their file, and also they cannot edit the existing file created by the root user. They don't have permission. Not even user 1, user 2, user 3, user 4, whatever user we have. So all the other users are having the same kind of permission. Whether we are having user 4. User 4 comes, log in, try to switch to the directory. It can successfully switch, it can list, but if it try to create a file into that directory, it cannot create. It will try to edit the file, it cannot. So this is the default permission. Now we want to change this default permission. So what I will do, I will use chmod command. Now chmod command, first I want to change the permission for the directory. Right now the directory is having read write execute for the owner user, read execute for the group owner, and read execute for the other users. Now I want to give other user execute write permission on the directory. So how we can do that? We can do that by using the chmod command, and also we have the option. We can use to give the permission by numerical way, and also we can use to symbolical way. Now numerical way is easy to give the permission. Remember the numbers, the decimal number for the permission. Read is 4, write is 2, and execute is 6. Now first user owner is having 7 permission, like read, write, and execute. I will not change this. Then the owner group is read and execute. That means total number is 5. 4 plus 1 is equal to 5. So this 5 is for the owner group. Then the last, the others are having this read and execute file, but I want to give them a write permission also. So when I add the 4 here, it will become 7. So numerical way of giving permission, changing the permission is very easy. You just have to count the numbers for read, write and execute. 7 means all the numbers are there, read, write and execute. 4, 2 and 1. 5 means read, execute. And 7 means again read, write and execute. So I'm doing what? I'm not changing default for this user owner and the group owner. I'm changing the permission for the other users. And then I will mention the directory or file. Whatever you want to change, you will mention the name of the directory or file. Now the permission is changed. Now when you check, now you can see that now other user is having the write permission. Now when you give the write permission on directory for other users, it will change the color to this. It will change the color of that directory. That means the users, other users are having the write permission on the directory. Now let's see users can do what. So I will go back to this user. Now it was not able to create the file. It was saying error here. Now it will try to create the file. And now it can create the file. So user 1 now can create the file, because now root user has given the write permission on the directory. So write permission means it can add the file and can remove the file also. Now this file is created by the user 1, and we can see, and this is the permission default for the user 1 also. Not only user 1, other users can also do, because it is for all the other users. Other users, for example user 3, now it can also create the file. Then also for user 4, so it can also create the file. User 4 can also create the file, user 3, user 2. So it is for the all users. Now in Linux, the directory permissions and the files permissions are separate. They are not together. It is not inheritance. That means in Windows, what happens when we give a permission on a directory, then all the files inside the directory and also the subdirectories will inherit the permission. By default, it do what? It inherit the permission. It inherit the permission from the parent directory. But in Linux, it is not like that. In Linux, the inheritance is not there by default. That means when we give the write permission on the directory, that does not mean the users will get the write permission on all the files inside the directory. For example, we have given the write permission on this test directory. User root has given the write permission to all the others on this test directory. But this file is inside the test directory, that is admin file. Now this admin file is belong to root user, and root user has not given any permission to others. It is only read. So still, even the directory has the write permission, this file does not have a write permission. So no user can edit the file. They can only read the file. As we see, this directory is having the write permission for others, but still the file inside the directory, this file is not having the write permission. So if user try to edit the file, they will get error. Whether it is user 4, user 3, user 2, no matter who, it will not able to edit the file, because they are not getting the write permissions. So there is no inheritance. If the user is not, if the directory is having the write permission, that does not mean all the file inside the directory will have the same permission. They are separate. So if user root wants to give the permission on this particular file, then it has to give the permission separately. So root user wants the other users to edit the file, then it will give the permission using the same command, chmod. And then again we can use the numerical way. like I want to give the other user 6, that means read write. By default it is 6 4 4, so I will give 6 4 6. That means first 6 is for the user owner, the second 4 is for the owner group, and the third 6 is for the others. And then I will mention the file name. Now I'm giving the name directly. I'm using the local path because right now I'm in the directory. So if I'm not in the directory, I will use the absolute path, saying test, under that this is the directory, this is the file. Now when you check, so this other users are now having the read write permissions. That means when you go on to check the other users, those who are not able to edit the file, but now they are having the write permission here, others, so they can do what? They can write. Now when the user one tries, it can write and save. Then user 3 also, it was denying previously, now it can also write, and it writes its own name here. Then also user 4, it was denying that time, now it is also able to write the file. And we can check, it is written there, it is written, this line was already there, these lines were added by these users, so it is edited because the user root has given the permission. So chmod command is to change the permissions. It is to change the permission. Now we change the permission numerically. That means we use the numerical way to change the permission. That is, we can use the number 1, 2 and 4 and combination of that. Now 1, 2 and 4, we can give like 1 is for the execute, 2 is for the write, and 4 is for the read. So we use 757, we can use 646, 666, 777, whatever. We can do the permissions like this. This is the numerical way. Now the other way is the symbolical way. We can use a symbolic way also to give the permissions. Now for symbolical way, what we have in symbolic way, when we say you, now you means what? It means user. We are talking about user, user owner. That means we are talking about the permission of user owner. Then when we say G, that means we are talking about the group owner permission. Then when we say O, that means we are talking about the other user's permission. So in symbolical way of giving or changing the permission, we use U for the user owner, G for the group owner, and O for the other users. Then also we can use the operators here. Operators here, that means plus. Now plus means we want to add some permission. Add some permission, that means already we have a read permission. Now we want to add the execute also. So we can do plus, we can use plus X. That means I want to add execute permission. Then if suppose we want to remove some permission, like we have already these read write. I want to remove write. So I can say minus write. That means I want to remove write permission. Then we have operator equal. Now equal means we don't care what is the permission. We don't want to see what is the permission. Whatever we want to give right now, it will be assigned. It is not like adding or removing, it is like assigning the permission. So no matter what is the, whatever the permission is there, like if suppose it is read write there, if I say execute, then it will only get execute. The previous permissions will be removed and overwrite. So when you use equal sign, it will remove all the previous permission, it will assign the permission what we are going to give. Now if we want to use this symbolical way, so we'll use it like this. Command will be same, chmod. Now we can see here for the admin file, this user owner is having read write. I want to add execute also. So I will say user plus I want to add execute on this file. Now you will mention file or directory, whatever. Now when you check, user owner is now getting the execute permission. Now remember, by default root user is also not getting the execute permission on their own file. That means user cannot execute their own file until they have the execute permission. Now when they have the execute permission, you can see the color of the file is changed. It is now showing that this file is executable file. Now this file does not have any content, but because of the permission, it is still called as a executable file. So this is what user owner plus, that means adding X means for execute permission. Now for example, this on this user one, other user, the group is having read write. I want to remove write permission from here. So I will use the same chmod command, and for the group owner, I want to minus write permission from this file. Now when you check, so here it is removed write. Then you can do assign also. Assign means no matter whatever the permission was, we are just assigning right now. So for example, this user 3 file, group other user is having read write. I just want to give other user assign. I want to assign read write and execute, or say I want to read write. I want to give read write on which file? User 3 file. Now this is assigning. So previously it was write, but now it is read write, whatever. It is not removing, it is not adding, it is what you are giving, you are assigning it. We can do it same time also. We can do it for all user group and others at the same time like this. We'll say chmod user I want to assign read write comma group I want to assign read comma others I want to assign read. Which file? Admin file. See, it is having different permissions, but I am assigning the permissions here, and I'm assigning for user group and others, all those together. Now you see it is changed like which we have assigned. Now what we did, we changed the permission. We change it through numerical way and symbolical way also. So numerical way, we can use the number combination of read, write and execute. And for symbolical way, we can just use the symbol of U for user, G for group and O for others. We can add the operators also, plus, minus and equal sign, that is for assign. Now you saw I logged in as a root user and I changed the permission of those other files, other users file. Other users, that means these users file, user 1, 3 and 4. These files owned by these users, but still root user can change the permission of these other users file. Because root is an administrator, so it has permission on all these files, special permission. So because of that, it can edit any user's permission. Any users, that means the file belongs to any user, owned by any user. Root user can change the permission of any user file, but users can also change the permission of their own file. Own file, that means if this file owned by user 1, so user 1 can change the permission of this file, but it cannot do anything to this other user's file. It cannot do anything, it can do only whatever the permission it gives. So if the other user gives the permission to this user as a write or execute, then it can do anything, otherwise it cannot change the permission. So other users, normal users, cannot change other users' permission. They can only change their own files, own file that is owned by those normal users. But root user can do change any user file, any file permissions. Now, if we want to change the ownership, so root user can also change the ownership of the file. So it can change the ownership of the file, it can give the ownership to other users and groups, and also it can take the ownership. Now, for example, this file is created by the root user and owner is root user. Now it wants to give this file to other user. So it can do by this ch own command. This ch own command is to change the ownership. It is to change the ownership of any file or directory. Remember, it is for the file and directory both. So whatever you want, you just give the name file or directory. So I want to change the ownership of this file. I want to give this file to user 2. Then I will mention the file or directory name, local path or absolute path. Now when you see, this file is now belong to owned by user 2. Now group is still root. Group owner is still root because it is a default. So now user 2 is become the owner of this file and the group owner is still root user. Now root user's primary group. Now user root can do what? It can change the group ownership also. I will create one group here first. Now I want to make this group owner group of this file or directory. So I will use the command chgrp and then I will mention the group name and then I will mention the file name. Now when you check, you can see now the group ownership is also changed. So now this file is owned by user 2 and the primary group is user this sales group. Now sales group, that means all the users of this group will get this permission. Now if you want to change both at the same time, that means user ownership and group ownership, then you can do it by using the ch own command. First you will mention the group username, then you will mention the group name. Remember, the first name is a username and the second name is the group name. Then we can use this, then we can mention the file or directory name. Now we can check, it is back to root root. Now you saw root user changed the ownership of its own file and give the ownership to user 2. Now when the user 2 becomes the owner, that user 2 can do anything to that file. But now user the root did what? It changed the ownership from user 2 to root again. That means user root can do what? It can give the ownership to anyone and also it can take the ownership from anyone. But normal users cannot do that. Normal users can also give the ownership of that files, their files, but when they give the ownership to other user, they cannot take it back because then the other user becomes the owner. And this user is not the owner, so it cannot do anything. So only root can do what? It can change the ownership from one user to other user. So this is how we change the ownership. Now one more thing, we can do these things recursively also. Now for example, I want to change a permission. I want to change the permission. Like 777. I want to change the whole permission and when I give the directory name, so it will change only the permission of this directory. It will not change the permission of all the files inside this directory. All the files, that means these are the files we have. So if we want to change the permission of the directory itself and all the files and directories inside the directory, then what we will do, we will use hyphen R option here. Now this will do what? It will do the permission, it will change the permission recursively. Now what that means, when you check the permission of the directory, so the directory permission becomes 777. Now when you check the permission of all the files inside the directory, they all become 777. Because we used this R option. This is for the recursive. Then same as for the ownership also, if suppose I want to change the ownership to owned by root user, all the files and the directories inside this, or maybe I want to change the group ownership to sales, and I want to do this for this directory and all the files inside this directory. So I will use hyphen capital R again. This will do the recursively change, and then it do what? It change everything. You can see the permission of the you can see the directory. You can see same user owner is this and the group owner is sales, and all the files inside the directory also have the same ownership. So for changing the permission or changing the ownership, we can use this hyphen R option to do it recursively. Because suppose you want to change some directory and all the files inside the directory, and in the directory you have hundreds of files, you don't want to change separately one file, each file one time, then you can do it recursively on the directory and all the files inside the directory will change. So this is what changing the files, changing the permissions, default permissions, and changing the ownership. Now, after this, this is what we have seen, how we can change the permission. But now I'll tell you the scenario here. I want to get, I will remove all these files right now. Now we don't have any file. I will create one file created by root user. I will name it as a admin, and I will say this is root user file. Okay, now we have a file with the default permissions. Now I want to do what? I want to edit the file. I want to give a permission for only user one, and I don't want to give the permission to any other user. That means by default all the users are getting read permission. Now I want to give a particular user write permission, and all the other user will remain with the read permission. Now how I can do this? Now suppose if I give a write permission on other users, then everyone will get the write permission. But I want to give only one user. I want to give user one write permission, and other users I don't want to give any permission. So how I will do that? So I can do that by using this primary group. Now this is the option. This is why we have the primary group with all the users, and user's primary group has its own permission. So what we can do here, we can add the user into this primary group. So how I will do this? We will do this by gpasswd hyphen a command, and then I will mention the username, and I will add that user into that particular group. This is the primary group. Then I will make the permission to that group. Group plus write on this file. Now by doing this, what I did, I give the root group user, group owner a permission of write, and I make that user which I want to give the write permission member of this group. Now if you switch to user 1, now it can see the file, it can write the read the file, and also it can write the file. Now if I try to log in with other user, I will say I want to log in as a user 2. So it can also see, can it read? It can also read, because other users have read permissions. But if it try to write the file, it is denied. Same as for all the other users, like user 2, user 3, they cannot write anything in this file. Not user 4 also. So I gave what? User 1 write permission and other users no permission. So how I did? I did it by adding the user into this group and giving this group a permission of write. Now there is a small problem here. I added the user, the normal user into the primary group of this root user. Now remember, this is a primary group of the root. That means what is the problem here? If any file created by the root, this group will always be the primary group, always be the owner group of all the files belongs to root user. Now I am added the normal user into this group for only this file, but this user 1 is now start getting the permission on all the files which owned by this group, and this is a root user primary group. That is very, very harmful. So I should not do this. I will remove the user from this primary group. So how we should do that? So we can only do simple, we can just change the ownership of group. We can change the ownership of the group to the group, normal group we create. This is the normal group we created. So I just change the ownership. Now this group will get what? This read write permission. Then I will add the user into this group. Now the user will get the read write, and also it will not get the permission on any other file because this group is only owned by on this file. So somehow we fix the problem. But this is what the basic thing. Now what about the advanced permission? Advanced permission, that means if suppose we are having the four users, let me remove this first. I will remove this user from this group first. Make these things normal. Then I will change the ownership also. To root, and then I will change the permissions also on the file. Now everything is normal. Now everyone has only read permission on this file, and we have four users here: user 1, user 2, user 3, user 4. Now what I want to do, I want to give user 1 read, write and execute all the permissions. Then I want to give user 2 only read write. Then I want to give user 3 only read. Then I want to give user 4 no permission. Now how I can do this? Now if I try, like what I know till now, if I try to make this user a owner, user 1, so it will get the permission of read write. I will make this user 1 owner, and then I will make the owner user permission read write execute. So user 1 will get read write execute here. Now for this user, I will make this user member of this primary group, and then I will change the permission of primary group to read write. So this user 2 will also get its own permission. Now for user 3, I will remain this user in others. So because of the others, it will get the read permissions. Now user 4, we don't want to give any permission. Now if we remain this user, if we leave this user as it is, then it will give the permission of others. Now if we remove the other permissions, if you remove others read permission, if you don't give other permission read, then user 3 will also not get read. So if you give read permission to others, user 3 will get read and user 4 will also get. If you remove the read permission from others, so user 4 will not get and also user 3 will also not get. Now this will not be solved by using the basic permission. We have to do the advanced permission for this. So for advanced permission, we can use separate permission for separate users. Now every file and directory has the default advanced permission. So if we want to see that, so we can see, we can use getfacl command. And then we will mention the directory or file name. So this is the default ACL of the file, and also the directory also. So directory and file both has a default ACL. So I said get file ACL command, and for this file we can see the default ACL is that file name is admin, owner is root, group owner is root, and also user owner is getting read write, group owner is getting read, and other users are getting read. Same we can get when we see this long list. We see the same same thing here, file name, and then owner user, owner group, and also we see the permission for owner user, owner group, and also for others. We see this here also. So this is the default ACL of any file or directory. Now we want to change this ACL. So we can change this ACL according to our need. For example, right now we want to give user 1 full permission read, write, execute without changing this default ACL. So default ACL will remain as it is, and we can change the permission for users by using the ACL permission. Now when we use the ACL permissions, then these default permissions will be override. That means if we give any ACL permission to any user, then for that user, not for everyone, for that user this default permission will be override. Now for example, we want to give the user 1 read, write, and execute. So we will use the command set FACL to change the default ACL, and I want to do modification for user. I want to add this user 1, and this user 1 I want to give read, write, and execute on this file or directory. Remember, file or directory we have to mention. Then I want to give user U for user, then you will mention the username, and then we will mention the permission. I want to give read write to this user to only read write. Then I want to give user 3 read only permission on this file. Then I want to give user 4 no permission. Now if I don't want to give any permission, I will give like this hyphen minus and then file or directory name. Now you can say that if I mention one by one every user name, then it will be very difficult for me. If suppose I have 50 users and I want to give all the 50 users read write permission, then mentioning all the names one by one will be difficult. So what we can do, we can create a group and we make those 50 user member of that group, and we can set the permission on group. So for setting the permission for group, we will use G here, G, and then mention the group name and then whatever the permission we want to give to that particular group, and then file or directory name. Now what we did, we changed the ACL permission, we changed the default ACL, and we added new users there with new permissions. Now when you see this by using the get FACL command, so now we can see here file name is this, owner is still root, group owner is still root, the owner user is still having this default permission, but now user 1 is also added with this permission, user 2 with this, user 3 with this, user 4 with this. Then group owner is also still having the read permission, but we added the new group here. Now because we have added multiple different permission for different users, it added this as a mask here, and then others are still remain with read permission. Now remember, I told you this permissions will override the default one. Now override the default one means what? If you see, the others are still having the read permission, so everyone will get the read, but for especially this user 4, it will not get the read also. It will not get any permission, because for user 4 it is going to be override this default permission. Now if suppose I remove the read permission from others, but still this user 3 will get the read permission, because for user 3 we have given the read permission here, and it is going to override the default permissions. Now when you check this by using this long list, then you can see the U mask is here, which is under the group section. And also you can see this plus here, this plus was not there, and this is for the advanced permission. Remember, I told you that for this dot here is introduced, indicate the advanced permission. Now, when there is dot, that means there is no ACL permission configured. But when you see the plus symbol here, that means there is a advanced ACL permissions are configured for this file, and you can see that only when you use this get FACL command. Now we will check how these users are getting the permissions. So first I will switch to user 1. Now this is the file. Now user 1 gets the read, write and execute. So first user 1 try to read, it can read the file. Then it will try to write the file. It can also write the file. It can say I can write the file. Then it can execute. Now executing the file, executing the script, how we can execute any file? So in Linux, we can have an executable file as a binary file, or we can have a file as a script file. Now for scripting, we have different languages. We have shell language, that is the basic language, basic shell, and we have then other languages like Python, which is created by the Python. Then we have Perl, which is created by the Perl language. Then we have the Ruby language also. Now if suppose the programmer has created the script by using the sh, default shell language, then they will use that file name with .sh extension. So this .sh extension indicates that the script is written under the sh. Now this is not relevant for the Linux will take it as a name, but for the user who wants to execute the script, for that it will be helpful that the user knows that this is written in the shell language. So if I want to execute this, I will use this command. So this command I will use to execute this script. Now if the programmer has written the script in the Python language, then it will name the file by using the extension py. The py extension is for the user but not for the for the system. System field is Linux system take it as a name, but for us it is important we know that this script is written in Python language. So we can do what? We can use the Python command to execute this script. Now if the script is written in Perl language, so the programmer will do what? It will add this extension pl. That pl indicates that the script is written into Perl language, and for running this we will use this Perl command. Then if it is written in Ruby language, so it will be named as a .rb. So we know that this is Ruby, language is Ruby, so we can run it by using this Ruby command. Now for running the sh file, shell language, we don't need anything, it is the default one. But for running the Python, Perl or Ruby, we need a binary files for that. That means we need the binary and library files installed before running this these script. Otherwise when you run the Python file and there is no binary, it will say Python is needed and Python is not found. When you run the Perl, it will say Perl is needed, Perl is not found. If you run Ruby without binaries and libraries, then you will run it, it will say Ruby required, it is not found. Basically you will not get the command. So if you have installed the Python, so the Python command will be there. And if you install the Perl, then you will see the Perl command will be there. So when you press tab, you will see the Perl command is there. And if you have Ruby, so the Ruby command will be there. Otherwise the command will not run. Now if user wants to execute it, but you see this file does not have any extension. We don't know what type of file is this, what language is this, is it a binary file or script, and whether it is written on shell, Perl or binary, Perl or Python or Ruby. So we can do what? For executing the any script, if we have all the binaries are there, Perl, Python, Ruby, everything is there. So what we can do, we can just give the absolute path with this file name. Remember absolute path, that means under slash we have the test directory, and in the test directory we have this file. So we just have to give the file name with the absolute path, and it is going to execute it. So whether it is going, it is a shell file, Perl file, Python, Ruby, it is going to execute it. And if the system requires Python, Perl, or Ruby, then it will indicate us, give the error. Otherwise, it will execute. When I run this, it is executed. But actually, in this file, there is no commands, there is no script, so it says no command found. But it is executed. And even you can run this if you are in the local directory. Like I'm already in the test directory, so I can do this dot for the present directory, because the file is right now in the present directory, then slash and then file name. So the main thing is to give the absolute path with the file name, and you can give the local path also like this. That means if you are under the same directory where the file is, then you can run it by using the local path dot present directory and then slash file name. Otherwise, you should give the absolute path. Now user 1 is able to execute it because it is having the execute permission. So it can execute it. It is not an executable file. It is not having any script, but still user can execute it. One more thing, if it is having the execute permission, so when it press the tab, it will complete the file name. Otherwise, it will also not complete the file name. Now I will switch to other user. I will switch to user 2 now. Now for user 2, we have given only read and write. We have not given the execute permission. So this is the file. User 2 can do read the file, and it can see what is the content inside it. Now user 2 can also write it. So it will try to edit the file, and it can edit this. User 2, user 2, user 2. And save this. Now user 2 wants to execute it. I will use the local path, and if I try to press tab, it is not completing because it is not having permission. I will give the name directly, and I will say I want to execute. Remember, user 2, we have not given execute. It says permission denied. That means user 2 is not able to execute the file. It has a read permission, write permission, but does not have the execute permission. Now I will log in as a user 3. Now for user 3, we have given read, and we have not given the write and execute. So user 3 can read the file. It can see the content, but if it tries to edit the file, it gets the permission denied. And when it try to execute it, it will also get the permission denied. This is user 3. Now for user 4, I will switch to user 4 now. Now for user 4, what we have given, we have not given any permission for user 4. No read, no write, no execute, nothing. So when the user 4 try to read the file, it is permission denied. Then it will try to write the file, permission denied. It will try to execute the file, permission denied. So it cannot do anything because we have not given the permission to user 4. So we can see the default permissions here. Then we can do other things also with this setfscl command. Like for example, you can use help here to see what other options we have. So we have multiple other options. This option is for modifying the ACL. You can use the capital M also to modify the permission from file. That means it will take the permission from the files. You can use X to remove the ACL. You can use B, capital X, for the file, from the file. You can use B to remove all permissions. Then you can use K to remove the default also. You have option to set N for no mask, D for default. That means operations apply to the default ACL. You can use recursive, logic, physical, version, help. Now for example, X, I want to remove the ACL permission. So if I want to remove the SQL permission for some user, so I will use X, then I will say user U, and I will mention the username. I want to remove user 4 from the ACL. Now the user 4 is removed. So when you check the get FACL command, you see the user 1, 2 and 3 is there, but user 4 is removed because I removed that user from the ACL permission. And if you want, then you can make the whole permission default. You can remove all the advanced permissions by just adding hyphen B. By just using this hyphen B, it will remove all. Now the file becomes default. Now you see all the other permissions are removed. Now it becomes like a default one. So this is what the advanced permissions we have. Now this is the advanced permission. So we have seen the permissions, what is the format of the permission, how it looks, and where it is coming, where the default permissions are coming. Then we saw that how we can change the permissions. Then we saw how we can change the ownership also. And then we have seen how we can assign the advanced permissions. But there are more permissions also remaining there. There are some advanced permissions remaining there. If you remember, I gave this umask command to see the umask. This is root user's umask, and the umask I said 022. This is 022, but there is one more zero is there. And what that zero is for, we will see in next lecture.